Cited is one of the founding fathers of the modern-day drag king movement. Moby Dick surfaced in 1995 in East Village of New York City. Quickly becoming media darlings, the drag king scene caught fire, and Moby Dick was the leader of the pack, taking the kings to newfound acclaim. Moby Dick is the brainchild of Mo Fisher, whose motto is, "Instead of being an angry woman, I became a funny man," as evidenced by this film clip.
Variety show.
And now, the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. You can't, I'm not the queer. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. With each and every highway, and that, much more than this, I did it my way.
Oh, hey. Hey, everybody. How you doing? Hey, I'm Moby Dick. I'm internationally known, no-nonsense, wise-cracking drag king host with the most. I'm here in my office, and I'm working on the next Kings of the World show. It features kings, queens, and in-betweens from all over the world. That's right, folks. Look at this. We've got Africa, Asia, Australia, Europe, North America, South America, and Antarctica. Sorry, folks. It's a little too cold for me. Folks, Kings of the World, the third Wednesday of every month, 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's right, folks. It's on twitch.tv.
Oh, wow. We've got some things to talk about. Mo, come on in.
Hello, gorgeous. How are you?
I'm doing fine, handsome. Good to see you.
Oh, terrific to see you.
Before we get into what Moby Dick does, what would you be doing today, or what were you doing before you created Moby Dick?
Before I created Moby Dick, I was in New York City, and I was going to the New School for Social Research. That's what I was doing.
That sounds pretty heavy.
Yeah.
What were your goals?
To try to figure out a career and try to, you know, actually before that, what I did was I was living and working in Kerala, South India, and I was working with Habitat for Humanity. I was there for 2.5 years, and I started 2 low-cost housing projects, and it was terrific. And India is one of those places. Either you love it or you hate it. And that's because it's the population. Some people just would be freaked out by the, you know, I loved it. Absolutely loved it. I love curry. I love everything about it. The sights, the smells, the beauty. The people are wonderful, wonderful, wonderful people. And it was great. I had a terrific time.
And then you happened to go to Provincetown for a summer. Tell us about that and what happened.
I did. And so I was living in New York City, and I thought, I cannot spend another summer there sweating my meat off. No way. It was too hot. So I said, let me go to Provincetown. It's beautiful. And, you know, it's LGBTQ Mecca, you know, why not? And so I hung out there, and I was waitressing and just chilling out, meeting all kinds of people and having a terrific time. And I met Busta Hyman and Julie Wheeler, 2 drag kings. And they said, oh, Mo, you ought to be a drag king. And I said, what? And, you know, at the time, I was Mo a go-go. I was go-go dancing. I was having a good time. And, you know, and I met Mistress Formica, who's a well-known drag queen. and from New York City. And Mistress and I, we were pals. We were great friends. And he was DJing for parties out of drag. And that's why I said he. And, you know, and so I was Mo Go-Go. We had a great time. It was really fun summer. So then I went and visited friends in San Francisco. And just so happened that a friend said, hey, I saved this article. And she had no idea that I just met drag kings. She said, I don't know why I saved this article, but here, I thought you'd be interested. And I said, oh my God, I just met drag kings. And so in that article, I became inspired by this woman who was very femme presenting during the day and this incredible transformation at night, secretary by day, drag king at night. And I thought, oh my God, anybody can do this, you know? And I thought, wow, why not? Because I had a very limited thinking. I thought you had to be a butch, you had to be a hardcore dyke, you know, this and that. And I thought, oh no, this is theater. This is fun. I can do this. So I went back to New York City. I got my hair cut and I'm walking to Mistress Formica's house with a handful of hair clippings. And I said, I got to get in drag. And he said, girl, you're crazy. And I said, yep. So he got me in drag and I walked down the street and it was the first time after living in New York City that I felt comfortable walking around because I didn't get harassed by the men. And I went to a local dyke bar and by the name of what was called Meow Mix. And I went there and nobody recognized me. And I saw Julie Wheeler and Busta Hyman. I was like, let's do this. And they were shocked. They said, oh my God. And that was November of 1995. And I was hooked, line and sinker. I said, I'm doing this. And by March of 1996, I started Club Casanova, which was the world's first weekly drag king party. And it went shablam. It was just gangbusters. We got a ton of press. It was so much fun. And you walked in and there was a drag king collecting money at the door. Then you see a drag king DJ. Then you see drag king go-go dances. And then there's drag kings walking around. Then I'm the host of the drag king show. Then there was a drag king show. And so you're just immersed in this whole drag king scene. And that's where strength in numbers, you know, you see, get everybody together and you're kaboom, you know, and people loved it. I unfortunately had to close it down because it made it, you know, New York City was very difficult with Mayor Giuliani when he was Rudy Giuliani, when he was mayor. Let's face it, he was a jerk and he's still a jerk. So we're not that surprised. But anyhow, he's now even a bigger jerk. But he was such a jerk and he wanted to close down all the bars. It wasn't just LGBTQ bars. It was everybody. So it's hard. You're hard pressed if you're an up and coming band to find a venue to, you know, start, you know, get your band together and practice. Even now it's hard. And, you know, so he had this antiquated law and all this nonsense. And I just said, I can't fight City Hall. So I said, that's it. I'm going to take the show on the road. And I created the first ever Drag King Cabaret show. And we toured US and Canada 3 times. And it's been a fun, wild ride. I can tell you that. Beats going so and been, New York School for Social Research. That's for sure.
I guess. So you've been a professional drag king for 28 years?
You're good at math, sister. Yes, yes, yeah. I took some breaks here and there, you know, so it wasn't through consistently, you know, but pretty much, yeah, I've been at it, you know, here and there, you know, just hosting a party, you know, working like the person at the door where people walk in, they're like, oh, hey, you know, and I greeting everybody and, you know, collecting the money. guest judge at the San Francisco Drag King contest. That's been going on for, holy moly, since, I want to say 1994, 93, 92, something like that. That's been going on for a long time. Fudgy Frottage, in San Francisco hosts that and hosts and produces it and has me come up all the time. And then, you know, recently doing dragkinghistory.com, that's been almost 6 years and started that in January of 2018. That was an idea that I had in the bath. I get these premonitions or these ideas, whatever you want to call them, when I'm either taking a nap or in the bath. And they come up and I said, I got to do this. And so I do it.
Tell us about your look. How did you develop the look of Moby Dick?
That's a great question. So when I first started out, I was, you know, adopting all these different looks and characters. And I thought, who is Moby Dick? And, you know, and I was a drunken sailor one night going to Jackie 60, this really fun party in New York City. And you know, then another night I'm this East Village grunge guy and I'm like, yeah, it's not quite it. And so I was asked to perform at the Gay and Lesbian Experimental Film Festival called Mix. And that was May of 1996. And I started doing this monologue that where I was just a schmuck of a guy, just a schmuck. And then I, as I was doing the monologue, talking about, hey, girls, tits and ass, and, you know, like kind of, you know, and that's where my motto came up. Instead of being an angry woman, I became a funny man, you know, and almost like Andrew Dice Clay, you know, like just stick it back, you know, at them. And I was feigning sickness. And then I transformed into a human fly and I lip synced to the song by the Cramps called Human Fly. And in doing so, like the subtext of that, look, men like this are pests. Pests have been around for thousands and thousands of years. So, you know, what are you going to do? You know, we can't beat them. So let's join them. And that's where I became a, you know, instead of being an angry woman, I became a funny man. And that was like the rockabilly guy, the wise guy, you know, that sort of look.
You've got the pompadour. Tell us about the gold tooth.
The tooth? Okay, I'm going to show you. See, so I had it made in Brooklyn and just snaps in and there you go. And I don't think this is the first time I think I've ever shown somebody that on camera, by the way, Amber. So look at that.
I feel honored. I feel honored. We mentioned earlier about your being in the film Pecker with John Waters. Tell us about that.
Oh, my God. Wow. Talk about a dream come true. What a guy. Amazing person. So I, you know, John reads newspapers, magazines every day, all day. Like that's his thing. Like he keeps up on everybody and everything going on. And so he was reading about me because, you know, we got a lot of press from Club Casanova and we were like the latest, coolest, fun thing to go and check out. And so he was, he had a new film, you know, Pekka, and he was, wrote a role in for me. And he was asking people, you know, said, you know, who's Mo, you know, are they cool? You know, what's going on? Making sure I wasn't an asshole. And so basically, and I, you know, I have good street cred, you know, so he invites me over to his apartment in New York City to interview me for a literary journal called Grand Street that was edited by Gene Stein. And this so cool. And I was like, oh my God, John Waters is interviewing me. Are you kidding me? And so he interviewed me. We had a great time. We were laughing our heads off and he hands me this script for Pekka. And he says, "Hey, read the script. Let me know what you think. I'd like to cast you as T-Bone the stripper." And I said, what? And I took it home and I was so in shock. I didn't realize he actually handpicked me for the role. And he calls me a couple days later. And he says, Kerry Barton, the casting director, is going to call you. Okay. And I said, okay. And I thought, do I have to audition? You know, he said he wants to meet you. So Kerry calls me up. We set up an appointment. I bring my book. You know, I had the book with all the articles and all the photos. And he's looking through, a very nice guy. And he says, all right, great. Great to meet you. And I said, do I have to audition? Like, what's going on? He goes, no, you were handpicked by John. And I went, oh my God, I couldn't believe it. And it was so much fun. Went down to Baltimore and my family has a history about Baltimore. My father had a chain of fast food restaurants called Gino's and they were named after my godfather, Gino Marchetti, who played for the Baltimore Colts. And our family best friend was Alan Amici, who was also played for the Baltimore Colts. And so my father met them from somebody he played. My father played for Ohio State. He played football.
The Ohio State.
The Ohio State University. Yes. Yeah, he played under Woody Hayes, who was like a big time, you know, football coach. And then he was going to play for the Green Bay Packers. This is my father. But he got an injury, couldn't do it, blah, blah, blah. Then was, you know, got into business and, you know, looked up his friend from college. It was Joe Campanella, who he was playing for the Baltimore Colts. And this is in the 1960s, the late 50s, 1960s. And so they started this restaurant, and cut to, I forgot why I was bringing that up, but so
Baltimore.
What? Oh, Baltimore. Thank you. And so I have this history of Baltimore, and I'm glad you're listening. I'm not paying attention. So when I went down there, you know, it was great. And, you know, there's funny. So the driver in my van who took me from, you know, the hotel to the film site, he says, "Oh, your father, he owned the Geno's." I said, "Yeah, yeah." I said, "Do you ever go?" He said, "As a matter of fact, yeah, I lost my virginity behind the Geno's." I said, "Okay, I don't need to know that, but okay, thank you." And it was just great fun. And John is an amazing person. We're still friends today. And when he's in town, I go to his shows and hang out. And, you know, amazing, amazing, amazing person. Just really incredible. Such an inspiration. And, all around fantastic person. Real, I can't say enough about what is.
How long were you on the set, or was your commitment to Pecker?
I was in Baltimore. I went about three separate times. And the first time I went, John said, "Oh, wow, you are the first character I'm working on." And then the final time was this group scene. Everybody was there, and we're in a bar, filming in a bar. And I'm dancing on a table. Patty Hearst is dancing on a table across the way. And I scream and I go, "Shake your money maker, Patty, shake your money maker." John is dying laughing. He's like, "What?" Everybody couldn't believe I said that. I was like, "What?"
So what are some of your other adventures with stardom?
Oh, you know, I stalked Phyllis Diller.
Phil Stiller is from my hometown.
Oh, what a fantastic person. Another fantastic person. So I read an article in New York Magazine that Phyllis was, you know, had people come over and you could look at her art and, you know, buy it. And I said, I want to go over to her house and buy her art. And I started getting obsessed with her. And I was reading all her books and reading everything. Everybody knew I was obsessed with her. It's kind of what happened with John. I was, you know, heard John was going to, you know, hanging out in New York. And I said, I want to be in a John Waters movie. I had an altar, you know, with his picture with a mustache, and, you know, all that. And so I did the same thing for Phyllis. And I said, I got to meet her. And so all my friends are sending me stuff in the mail, you know, books and paraphernalia, whatever they could find about Phyllis Diller. So I had a book in my car and I said, you know, if I'm ever in her neighborhood here in LA, LA is really spread apart. You know, it's not like you're just right there. And I said, I'm going to ask, I'm going to drop it off in her mailbox, see if she would sign it. So she didn't have a mailbox. So I ring the doorbell and they said, oh, come on in. I said, what? And so I drive in, she's got this big gate, huge driveway, drive up, pull up. And I'm like, oh my God. And I ring the doorbell. They said, hey, welcome. And I said, oh my God, I can't believe this. And her secretary, Carla, says, how you doing? I said, I'm good. I said, I have a book and I was wondering if Phyllis would sign it. And she said, well, she's busy right now, but yeah. And I said, I'd love to buy her art too, you know, and see her stuff. And she said, oh, sure. And so she says, oh, just walk around and pick anything you want. And I said, what? And it was unbelievable, Amber. I mean, every inch of her house was covered in art. I got a boa. I got a couple pictures. Like she, you know, just draw, like she would get a toilet paper, you know, a roll of toilet paper. And she'd be like, just draw on that, you know, a tissue box, open it up and draw on that. She was just obsessed with, you know, always having to draw. And it was amazing. And then her secretary says, listen, why don't you get a party together, get more people, and, you know, you can come out and meet Phyllis. And I said, all right. So I got a big gang of us and we all show up at the same day, same time, everything, big group of us. We're all looking around her entire house, you know, and she had champagne serving everybody, had a waiter there, you know, it was amazing. And then after it all, she autographs everything for us and meets every one of us. And this was, God bless, this was a couple months before she died. So we were really lucky, really lucky. Amazing woman. So gracious. Incredible. Yeah.
Oh, my. What a nice, nice story. She was from Lima, Ohio. That's where she got her start.
All right. Yes, yes.
Now, in the drag queen world, there are different categories of drag queens. You know, there's the pageant queens. There's the female impersonators, the female illusionists, the clown queens, which I probably am off to that, born that category. Are there different categories in the drag king world?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, it's interesting. So I got these books behind me, and this is all drag king history. There was a professor by the name of Esther Newton. I don't know if you've heard of Esther, an amazing, amazing woman. So Esther wrote a book called Mother Camp, and that was it was an anthropological study of drag queens in the late 1960s, early 1970s. And in that's where she talks about the hierarchy. Excuse me. The hierarchy. I don't know what I ate for lunch, but woohoo, it's coming back. I got agita. Anyhow, so she talks about the hierarchy, female impersonators, drag queens. And I forget that there was like something else, and then street queens, yeah, all that. But that's where I first learned about the hierarchy. And drag kings also have that hierarchy. They're not, I wouldn't say many male impersonators. Male impersonators were more historical. Like you had Stormy DeLarbier. You ever hear of the Jewel Box Review?
No.
Oh my God. You got to look that up, because the Jewel Box Review was the first ever interracial queer. Well, they didn't call it queer in the 1950s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, you know, gay and lesbian tour, cabaret show. And it was incredible. You got to look it up because it was incredible. Stormy DeLarbier for 15 years was the sole male impersonator, was the MC of the show. And at the end of the show, it was family entertainment. And this was wild, wild, at a time of segregation and intense homophobia, right? In the 50s and 60s. Incredible that they were traveling the country openly queer, openly gay and lesbian, you know, and doing these shows as, you know, female impersonators and a male impersonator at a time when they would have been arrested. And it was just incredible that they were able to do this. Just phenomenal, phenomenal shows. Anyhow, so male impersonators from a male mimicry perspective is more historical, where today you don't have as many male and people identifying, say, as a male impersonator. Maybe like in opera, you've got breeches roles, you've got in travesty, and travesty means in disguise. But then you've got, so if you want to do like the, you know, different categories, you got the comedy king, you know, the singing kings. And then there are the male illusionists, and then the pageant kings, you know, they have a whole, I think they call themselves male impersonators now that I think about it, but they definitely say male illusionists, but that's a whole genre and a whole, you know, thing that you've got emperors and, you know, part of that whole scene. So it's a wide variety of, you know, male mimicry, if you, you know, want to put it like that, you know what I mean, in our community, which is really cool.
Now, a lot of people who have transitioning from male to female start out as a drag queen. You know, that is their foot in the door.
Gateway drug.
Yes. Same thing in the drag king world.
Yeah, there were a lot of drag. So in my time, you know, like in the 90s, there were a lot of drag kings who were like, I kind of like this mustache a little too much. And then they, you know, went on to transition. And I thought, you know, they said, I'm not going to perform as, you know, myself. They just thought it was weird. Where today there's openly, you know, they're drag kings who are who have transitioned, who still perform because they, you know, they're like, it's entertainment, you know, and I'm being a larger than life male. And, you know, so it's very cool. And you've got more non-binary, you know, like today the gamut of monikers or identifiers, you know, is really broadened, which is really cool. And what's really cool too, I have to say, is how drag kings have evolved And, you know, my day, there was Diane Tor, who taught the Drag King workshop. And Diane Tor, along with Johnny Science. Johnny Science was a female to male, you know, transsexual. And I say transsexual because that's how he identified. People today would never say that. They're like, oh, you can't say that. Well, yeah, if that's how he identified, that's how he identified. So he was, he worked on the makeup. He wanted to appear more passing. And so he was, you know, really working on that look and teamed up with Diane Tor. They created this drag king workshop, and then all kinds of people took it. And this was, Diane had been starting to perform and do, you know, male characters in the 80s. And Johnny was, had been transitioning during that time, and he was already living his life as a male, and et cetera, et cetera. And so it was like a perfect match made in heaven. So they collaborated, did this, and that inspired everybody. And so I'm an accolade of that, you know, that workshop, because I didn't actually take it, but it was a whisper down the lane. So Buster Hyman took it and said, I said, I want to be a drag king. How do I do this? And so Buster gave me, you know, the whole skinny, gave me all the information and the how to's. And then we shared the information that way. And whereas, and we were passing. So we were the Diane Tor School of Realness. And so today you see more elaborate makeup and contouring and cosplay and more costume. And it's fantastic. I love it.
Couple of years, we've done several shows talking about the anti-drag, anti-gay activity going on over the country. We've had drag queens whose shows have been interrupted by Proud Boys, where police have had to come in. Yeah. Have you experienced any of that?
No, thankfully, no. And, you know, LA, I like to think I'm protected here, but, you know, just not too far away, the Proud Boys I don't know if it was the neo-Nazis. You know, they were going into PTA meetings, you know, into schools, grade schools, and complaining, you know, about kids possibly trans and, you know, just stupid stuff. But they haven't really hit up the LA, you know, so much. You know, I'm grateful, you know, for that. And why they're even doing it is just beyond my comprehension. You know, Lillian Faderman is a terrific lesbian historian. And I heard her speak, and she's out of Fresno, and a lot of books up here she wrote. And so she was talking about, she said, look, you know, that, you know, with the gay and lesbian community, you know, so there has been a lot of, you know, two steps forward, one step back. So we're in that one step back, and, you know, ride the wave, and because we're going to keep going further. And stuff. So, and I just think it makes people more engaged in our community, and makes our makes us wake up more. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, if you want to call us woke, have at it. I like it, you know, but it makes us, you know, more, there's more engagement, there's more community building, and then it creates more awareness. And so when, you know, shit goes down, then we rise up.
Very good. What's in store for Moby Dick? What's happening in the future?
Well, I'm actually going to Stanford, you know, in January, and I am going to be, I got a couple shows coming up. So I'm going to Stanford. I'm going to MC an event, a book that I wrote, an essay, Drag King Murray Hill, you know, that, you know, and we'd all love. So Murray Hill, when he came, first started performing at, he came to Club Casanova, and I remember him like it was yesterday. He would show up and he had this Benny Hill grin, and he would just be looking at all of us and like, what is going on? I want to be a part of this. And he'd come in, and he was doing a party at somewhere else. He was hosting a party down the street. So he'd come in, catch our show, and then take off. And I said, who was that guy? Where is he? What is he? You know? And finally we got a call, you know, hold of him. And so he did his very first time performing was in December of 1996. And after that, he was going to the School of Visual Arts and for graduate school. And his professor said, listen, you know, you're getting more involved in this drag king community. And, you know, why don't you create this character? You know, you got this character. Why don't you do, you know, basically he did his thesis on Murray Hill running for mayor of New York City against Giuliani. And so I wrote an essay for this book trans herstory, not in 99 objects. And the photograph, the object that I was writing about was a photo of Murray as, you know, running for mayor, this like beautiful photo. He's got the, you know, red, white, blue tie with the Statue of Liberty and, you know, and in his Navy suit and just, you know, proud as a peacock. That Della Grace Volcano, this amazing photographer, took the photograph. And so I, you know, wrote about that. And so I'm emceeing that event at Stanford, of all places. And then I'm going to be doing a comedy show March 13th. And I'm working on doing a show that I will be doing myself, like a big full show. And yeah, so I recently, I have to tell you, I had a double hip replacement. So I've been at it for a long time, you know, and my body is wearing down, but I'm doing good. That was in September. I did a one and done. I was like, just get them both done at the same time. And arthritis and, you know, is hereditary in my family. So I'm doing great, but, you know, I'm still slowly working towards doing my show. Let me put it that way.
What, tell us about that show. What some of the things you're thinking about?
Well, I'm going to do some, you know, comedy, you know, some stand-up comedy. I'm going to be doing monologues to music. Not ready for the choreography yet, just yet, but I'm going to, you know, incorporating choreography. I'm a terrible singer. I don't think I'm going to really mix in too many songs. I'll probably, you know, lip sync to them. And like I said, do the monologues to music, but just kind of a variety, telling some of, you know, some of my story, you know, just, you know, certain things and playing music that I love. I grew up in the punk rock era, you know, and I love punk music. I love rock and roll. I love rockabilly, you know, hence the look, you know, and, you know, and so those are the, it's going to be more that and, little rough and tumble.
Where do you hope to perform this?
I'm not sure yet. You know, my favorite place had to close down and we're waiting for it to reopen. It's a Cavern Club Theater in Casita del Campo here in Los Angeles, but there's a lot of other places. And the person who runs that, Mr. Dan, is going to be the director of my show and, you know, and stuff. And I've got a costumer and, you know, I've got my wig people, you know, so I got it. I got all the ducks in a row. I just got to get going. You know, I got to, my body is getting up there. So, you know, I've got to get it, you know, getting up there, meaning I'm getting back in shape. So after my surgery and I'm walking easy and hiking and, you know, so I'm not sure when that's going to be, but dragkinghistory.com is something that we're revamping the website. And in January, it's going to be, we're going to have merch up and we're going to have, you know, all kinds of stuff. You can rent a video that I did that explains the rise of drag kings. Because so many people said, how did drag kings come about? How does, you know, so from, you know, Diane Tor, it's just actually, it's from the feminist movement. And then, and, you know, then, and LGBTQ, well, at the time they didn't use Q, but the gay and lesbian, you know, movement in the 60s and 70s, and then moving from that onto where we are today. And so you could rent that video on our site, you know, that's, it's a whole talk, a lecture. And I do lectures actually for drag king history. We do colleges and universities. I just did a Circa, the first ever queer histories festival. That was a part of one institute. And that was great. It's a great turnout and it was great fun. And just, I love sharing the information. Drag King History, like I said, it started in January, 2018 as an idea in a bathtub. And when I started doing the research, I went, oh my God, this is bigger than me. You know, because I found a paper that somebody, a professor wrote and on his thesis on about male impersonators from the Tang Dynasty in China. And so they do male impersonation in Chinese opera. And I mean, that it goes way back. So then I go through history, you know, and through to where we are today, you know, with the lecture that I do as well. And that's great fun. And I love it. We have a whole PowerPoint presentation that's colorful and, you know, looks great. And then we identify to the lesbians that, you know, through history that, you know, performed and whatnot. And so it's great fun.
Very good. Mo, thank you so much for talking to us. It's a fascinating story of what you've done, but what you're going to do is even more fascinating. So thank you so much for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
Wow.